Hola, buenas tardes, good afternoon, my beautiful people. Welcome back to the channel. I'm so glad you could make it for another video here with me. As always, it's your girl here, Daniela, aka Four Lizard, and today I want to talk to you about books. I have sitting in front of me a stack of books because I have been kind of buying a lot of books recently. There was like a phase in my life where I wasn't buying a lot of books and I was being pretty good about moving books out of my collection. And then I ended up just buying a bunch of books in the last couple of months. And I feel like these are the books that I'm really going to sink into in 2022. Hopefully I get these finished in 2022. That would be great. Although some of these are huge, so we shall see if that happens. But anyways, I just want to share with you all the books that I recently picked up, that I'm currently reading, that I'm about to read, and that are on my like up next list of books that I'm going to read. So if any of that sounds interesting to you, just keep on watching. Alright, we'll start off with the book that I started yesterday. This is Anne Leckie's The Raven Tower. I'm really excited to read this book because I just read Ancillary Justice, which was her like famous sci-fi book last year. And so I'm just hopping on to the Anne Leckie train, but I really enjoy her writing and her concepts. The Raven Tower is more of a fantasy than it is a sci-fi from what I can tell so far. I'm only on page 40, but it reads to me more like a fantasy than a sci-fi. And she's, I think, more well known for her sci-fi than her fantasy. I could be wrong about that. So The Raven Tower is set in another world. It's like set in a fantasy world, and from what I can tell, it's about the relationships between gods and humans. So I'm really excited to continue reading this. I am reading this for a book club that I'm part of, so I was really excited to see that they picked an Anne Leckie book for the book club. And so far, I really enjoy the writing. Anne Leckie, for me, always brings something like fresh and innovative. It makes me really like fall in love with reading and books all over again, because I feel like at this point in my life I've read so much that it's hard for me to like really see something absolutely like different than what I've seen before. And I feel like Anne Leckie always brings that like that taste of freshness that is super super exciting. The second book that I just started as well is The Inheritance of Orquídea Divina by Zoraida Córdova. And not gonna lie, I bought this for the cover. Yes, I'm one of those that buys books for their covers. I judge a book by its cover. Guilty. Yes, guilty as charged. I bought it for the cover, but I also bought it because she is a Latina author, and of course I support my Latinas. I'm not sure exactly what this is about besides that it is set in Ecuador and also I think in the United States, but it is about this magical family. I feel like there's elements of magical realism in it, and I think from what I can tell, it's a story of magic, of family, of the relationships that people have across generations. So I'm really looking forward to continuing to read this book. I just barely started this. Like, I finished the prologue and that's it. And so far I do really like it. I like the writing, but we shall see. It's one of those books that I feel is really hyped up. And when books are really hyped up, I kind of approach them with a little bit more of like a more critical eye, because I tend to not really enjoy like a lot of the mainstream books out there. So when something is hyped up, I always feel like I'm not gonna enjoy it. The third book up, The Body Keeps the Score: Brain, Mind, and Body in the Healing of Trauma. And this is a chunky book too. It's about 430 pages. And this is a nonfiction piece of work about the psychological damage that trauma causes. And actually, I didn't buy this. My sister lent this to me. She really liked it and recommended it. And so I took it and I put it on my, you know, stack of books that need to be read. I love taking people's recommendations because it really forces me to read things that I don't tend to gravitate towards myself naturally. And the reason that she gave this to me was because we grew up in an abusive household, and in a lot of ways, it traumatized us. And it wasn't until we were adults that we started to really unpack and unravel the damage that we had as children. And I feel like my sister's always trying to continuously unpack things from our childhood and our past. And it's interesting because I feel like I took a very different approach to it, and I kind of just don't want to think about it. I leave it in the past. But a lot of the times, like, you can't really always leave trauma in the past. It's gonna be with you no matter where you are, where you go. I think this is gonna be a good book for me to like reflect on my own experiences and think about, my reaction to and my like feelings and thoughts towards like what happened to us as children. And so it's gonna be a heavy read, but I'm really looking forward to understanding myself more in terms of like how I respond to, like, how I've responded to trauma. So we shall see how this is. Again, I'm the type of person who wants to like leave things in the past, but a lot of the times you can't do that. It just doesn't work that way. You have to really face the past in order to move on to the present. And so it's important to always think about like where you come from and your roots so that you don't let your trauma continue to shape your life. So this one's gonna be interesting. I'm glad to be reading nonfiction too. I tend to not read as much nonfiction because I am a data scientist, so I read a lot of nonfiction constantly for my work. And so I do like to read more fiction when I am, reading for pleasure and not for work. So next book up, I Am Not Your Perfect Mexican Daughter by Erica L. Sanchez. I actually finished this last month. It was one of the last books I read in 2021. This is a YA book, and I didn't realize it wasn't a YA book. I had a professor from undergrad recommend this to me, and I tend to trust his judgment, and so I picked it up and I don't like YA writing. I just have to say that. And I haven't read every single YA book out there, but the ones I have read, I don't like their writing. And I don't like the writing in this book either. I think it's very simple and boring. But the concept, the story itself, the characters were interesting. This was sort of a mixed bag for me. I liked the story and the characters and the concept, but it was hard for me to look past the very plain and uninspired writing style. So, next on my list is Braiding Sweetgrass by Robin Wall Kimmerer. This is Indigenous Wisdom, Scientific Knowledge, and the Teachings of Plants. This is a book that I feel like got so much hype, and I feel like in this case it's a well-deserved. And this is about the holistic ecological relationship between the natural world, plants, animals, the land itself, and us as humans. And I think that this book is going to teach me a lot. I actually started reading this book last year with my boyfriend, but I kept on falling asleep when he would read it to me. We were trying to read it to each other before we fell asleep at night, and I would always fall asleep. Not that this was boring. I have to like zoom in really closely if you to see the cover, because the lights wash it out. But not that this was boring. It was not a boring book. It's just that his voice reading would soothe and calm me, and I just would fall asleep. But I'm so excited to read that book. Next book on my list, this thing is huge. It's a whole history course. This is 100 Years of Socialism by Donald Sassoon. It's all about socialism in Western Europe, in the 20th century. And this thing, again, is huge. I am really interested in socialism. I feel like I tend to lean towards socialism as a political ideology. And so I just want to learn more about it, its history, how it's developed throughout throughout time and how people have deployed it in various eras and countries. We'll see how much I get through that book. Next book, The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. I found this in my local thrift store for $1. This is a very well-known book among scientists. It's all about the development of science as a field and as a, you know, set of knowledge and belief systems. And it talks about the various scientific revolutions that have occurred since the development of the field and what each one meant and what each one was characterized by. So many people that I know have read this book, and I kind of know what it's about, but I just haven't read it, and so I always feel like a bit of an imposter when I talk about this book, because although I do know the concept that this book is, what this book is about, I haven't read it. And it's a relatively short book, it's about 200 pages, so I figured it was about time I read this book. Moving on to another chunky monkey, this is Alexander Hamilton by Ron Chernow. Look at this thing, this is 800 pages. It's huge. Okay, so this thing has been on my bucket list, my reading bucket list forever because I am obsessed with the Hamilton soundtrack. I've never watched the play itself, but I've listened to the soundtrack on repeat. It's so phenomenal. I listen to that soundtrack like once a month at least because it just motivates me, it energizes me. Like I know the lyrics to the songs, you know, if there's a karaoke and Alexander Hamilton's like, I know every single word to those songs. Oh, they're so good. But as you can see, like on the front, it says the inspiration for the hit Broadway musical. But I love that soundtrack so much that I knew that I eventually would have to read this book. And it's an autobiography. I always want to say autobiography. This isn't a biography. This is a biography of Alexander Hamilton. It's huge. But beyond that, it's also like a history book about that particular time, like the founding of the United States, and a really close look at the politics and the society of the time. So I'm really, really excited to sink into this once I get there. Okay, so this book, The Last Beautiful Girl by Nina Loren. I actually just finished this book. This was the first book I finished in 2022, and this is a book I read as part of a book club that I am in with my sister and sister-in-law, and my sister picked this book because it was on her bookshelf. She's not into YA, and neither am I, and so it was funny that we were reading this together, and we're both not into YA, but this is a YA fiction. It's kind of noir, like it's a ghost story about a high schooler, who becomes like insta-famous, but then she runs afoul of the haunted house that is helping her make her famous, but also trying to possess her. And so it's a ghost story, it's kind of noir, but it's very modern because of the whole Instagram celebrity thing. And I just cannot be inspired by a story about Instagram. I'm sorry, I can't. The writing was also pretty basic. And so while this was a fun read, and I think I would have enjoyed it when I was like 13 or 14, I'm 28 and this is not it for me, but it's a beautiful cover, beautiful. Okay, so next on my list, this is a little book. This is Coffee Art by Don Tamang, and this is about creative coffee designs for the home barista. So I love coffee, I love lattes, and I love latte art. And one of my New Year's resolutions is to learn how to do latte art. I've always loved like the design on like a latte, and I just want to learn how to do that for myself. So this book is all about, you know, creating designs. It gives you step-by-step instructions on how to make latte art. And I'm really excited to just dive into this and make my own latte art designs at home and feel super bougie, like at home with my, you know, barista level, cafe level, gourmet level latte. So I'm so excited. Okay, we're almost nearing the end of the stack here. This is a book that I started a while back and I kind of left off with it, but I want to get back into it. This is called Zen and Japanese Culture by Daisetsu T. Suzuki. And I try to read, or I try to be reading like constantly, a book about mindfulness or meditation. I always like to have a book about mindfulness or, you know, calmness, meditation. I like having like that type of book on my nightstand that I can read a couple of pages before I fall asleep. Reading about mindfulness or meditation techniques or Zen or like similar, you know, similar like wellness and holistic type of practices like that really motivates me and inspires me to continue to practice those in my everyday life. So Zen for me kind of is in that same realm of like meditation, mindfulness, wellness, spiritual living, mindful living, that kind of stuff. And so I thought it would be cool to read this book, particularly because I'm very interested in Zen and I just want to learn more about it. I want to learn how it's practiced. And this book is all about how Zen is practiced in Japanese culture and how it kind of influences different aspects of Japanese social and cultural life. And this is pretty much a textbook. It's very technical. You can tell that the person who wrote it was a historian and a scholar, and so it is a little bit of a heavy read. It's not super light reading, but it is very interesting. Okay, this is a little book that I got just for fun. I picked it up at my local thrift store for a buck. This is an astrological book on the zodiac sign Taurus. And in case you didn't know, your girl is a Taurus. She is a lady bull. And I feel 100% Taurus. So I've never owned one of these like cutesy little astrology books. But I figured it would be fun to kind of check out as a light little read, and I was drawn to it, so. All right, another chunky monkey here. This is The Unknown Story, Mao, by Jung Chang and John Halliday. So this is a biography of the controversial political leader, Mao Zedong, of China's Cultural Revolution, and this is not light reading. This is a very in-depth biography of this super complex, mysterious, iconic figure. I don't know too much about Chinese politics or about Mao Zedong at all. And so that's why I wanted to read this, because Mao Zedong is such a controversial figure, to say the very least. So many people absolutely abhor him and so many people absolutely adore him. So definitely there's a lot going on there, and I just want to learn more about Chinese history, Chinese politics, Chinese economics. So I saw this at my local thrift store, $2. It was $2 and I had to pick it up. So we'll see how that book is. All right, last two books in my stack. George R.R. Martin's A Clash of Kings. So I've actually never watched the show or read the books, and this is actually the second book in his epic fantasy, The Game of Thrones. The first book, of course, being The Game of Thrones. I haven't read that one yet, but I do plan on reading the series starting soon. So I saw this in my local thrift store, and so I just picked it up because I knew that eventually I'm gonna get to the second book. So hopefully I'll find the first book at a thrift store or a used bookstore soon, so that I can start the series soon. I never was super into like the Game of Thrones. When everyone was watching it, I never got into it. It did seem interesting, it did seem cool, but I was already just like watching other things, reading other things, and so I never like got around to reading or watching the Game of Thrones. But I think I don't know. I feel like I'm in the mood to start like a really epic fantasy journey, and I figured why not read the Game of Thrones and then watch the Game of Thrones after, now that it's all like done and finished. And so I'm looking forward to just like sinking into this long epic fantasy. All right, the last book in my pile, Salt, Fat, Acid, Heat by Samin Nosrat, Mastering the Elements of Good Cooking. I also picked this up at my local thrift store for $5, which is such a steal considering this thing is like $40 at Barnes and Nobles. And this thing is brand new. It does not look at all used or read, so I'm excited. This is such a famous book. I've seen so many people talk about it and read it. And honestly, the reason why I picked up this book is because one of my New Year's resolutions in 2022 is to be better at meal prepping and to find joy in cooking and to be a better cook. I've always been someone who doesn't like cooking. Even though I like good food, I just don't like to cook it. I'd much rather be, camping, drawing, hiking, lounging in a beach chair, shopping, watching TV. You name it, I'm excited to do anything else besides cooking. And I think that's always stemmed from the fact that I'm not very good at cooking, and I don't really like doing things that I'm not very good at. But, cooking, like everything, it takes practice. And so my goal in 2022 is to spend more time cooking, practice cooking, be better at cooking, and learn more about cooking technique, cooking history, cooking fundamentals. So that way I just feel more confident and able in the kitchen, because it definitely is a skill that I want to learn. I want to be able to cook good, delicious, nutritious food and also cook for my family and friends. And yeah, that's just one of my goals this year. And that is it. That is all. I hope you enjoyed listening to me talk about books. I'm so excited to jump into all of these new books. Definitely let me know what you are reading in the comments down below. I would love to know. And if you have any book recommendations, just drop them down below in the comments as well. Thank you so much once again for stopping by and checking out this video, and I will catch you in my next video. Bye, guys.